Hello and welcome to The Reformation, Video 3, The Printing Press, How It Changed Values, Traditions, and Philosophies. In SOL 3C, we will describe the changing cultural values, traditions, and philosophies of the Reformation and assess the role of the printing press by writing a narrative that contrasts the intellectual and material culture of before and after the Reformation. Here's the big picture. At first, the Reformation divided the countries of Europe on religious principles, like the different beliefs, and that led to religious intolerance because the Catholics and Protestants were in conflict, and just like in any war, you're either with us or against us. And in some ways, the printing press made this worse because it spread these agitating ideas. But eventually, most power in European states was concentrated in the monarchs' hands as opposed to the churches, which is a big shift. And because it became less and less about religion over time, religious toleration emerged. But before this, once upon a time, education, scholarship, and literacy were limited to the church, and dissenters were severely punished. Here's a statue of Giordano Bruno, who was he was burned at the stake by the church for his beliefs. He had some very clear scientific beliefs about the sun being the center of the universe and that sort of thing, but he also believed that Jesus wasn't the Son of God, which for the Christian church was kind of a big deal. So he was burned for all of his ideas that he wouldn't let go of. But that's really how the church treated people who disagreed with them before this time period, because they could, and because it felt like the right thing to do. I shouldn't totally criticize them, but I will. But then, slowly things changed. There were these translation movements, and let me say that there's two real stages to this. So the Greek and Roman ideas back from the classical period in ancient history, they were really far advanced of even when, in terms of the actual mechanics of it, knowing how the world worked, medical knowledge, lots of different things, ahead of where Europe was during the Middle Ages. So Europe had kind of moved backwards in some ways in terms of knowledge. So that knowledge transferred from the Greek and Roman world over to the Islamic world, to the Muslim empires of the Middle Ages. And that happened through a couple different channels, but basically it was getting translated from Latin and Greek over into Arabic, which was a language that all of the Muslim world used. And that way, even if you lived in Spain in the Muslim world, or you lived in Baghdad, many, many thousands of miles away from each other, you could speak the same language, read the same books, talk about the same things, send letters to each other. And those ideas resulted in a golden age of science and thought in the Islamic empires. And those things were then translated back into Latin and went to Europe and touched off a new enthusiasm for old learning and knowledge and new knowledge and creation of new ideas. And that fundamentally changed the intellectual sort of ecosystem, the culture, the climate of Europe at the time. The church loses power as a result of the Protestant Reformation and kings taking power for themselves. And the ideas were being spread by printing, and these new ideas, because there had been space cleared by the fall of the church, so there's a sort of power available to go around, and new ways of doing society were more acceptable in especially Protestant situations. So these new ideas spread by printing, given this good climate for those new ideas, makes for whole new kinds of societies. And there's lots of people who try lots of new ways of living together, new ways of being families, and even down to that individual level of who you should be as a person. So let's talk about the printing press. The growth of literacy was huge in this time period because there was easier access to books, because you had print shops like this turning out hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of books in short stretches of time. Books are more accessible, and especially broadsides or just sheets posted up different places were accessible, and it became valuable to you as a person to know how to read, and so people found ways to learn how to read. That's really, economics can be used to argue for a lot of things in history, but the Bible was printed in English and French and German. Before, it had only been printed in Latin, and very few people read it other than priests. And the idea in the Catholic Church was the priest is interpreting things for you, you peasant. You know, it's fine. You'll understand someday. But the Protestant Church had this focus because Martin Luther believed in the Bible as the ultimate authority, that every Protestant should read the Bible, that was a big part of being a Protestant, or at least have access to those ideas. And so the Bible being printed in French and English and German allowed individuals to have access to the Word of God and that Christian belief about the purpose of the written word in religion. And the printing press also helped to spread the ideas of that Reformation, like I was just talking about, but also the Renaissance, like humanism, like the different methods of painting. like the new ways of doing business, like the information that they learned from trading in far-off places. It was able to spread much, much faster and stick around longer. So here is a picture of the printing press in use. I got this one because it's a little closer up. But this guy, you can see, is turning this screw, which then presses this down. And this is actually just a big sort of stamper. And it holds this tray, which is full of little metal pieces of type, like little letters on the ends of metal rods, which then, or sorry, not actually here, the tray's down here. And then this paper is being pushed on top of that tray. And as a result, it pushes ink onto the paper. And then you have a printed page, which is much faster than writing it yourself. This is William Caxton, a later, much later depiction, like 400 years after he was alive, was this picture made. But William Caxton, the English printer, showing the printing process to Edward IV and his queen and their children in or around 1477, because 1877 was the 400-year anniversary. So here's the real thing. Like, the printing press, we always talk about the printing press being the big deal. But there had been printing presses before this, and there had even been, you could take wood and carve into a thing and just stamp it over and over. Stamps were a thing before this happened. And in China, they had been using stamping techniques, even using some metal stamps before this. But the big deal change was what you see right here. This is upside down, so you're going to have to, like, sort of tilt your head a little bit. But these are words. And each of the letters here, for the most part, are what you see down here. They're actually long metal rods that have these letters cut to the end of them. So if you stack them up together and you press them together like this, then you can actually use them to print over and over and over and over. Just put a little ink on there, put the page down, press it on. Take it off, more ink, press it on. Take it off, more ink, press it on. And you can make page after page after page, and it can be really efficient. You can make a lot of books very quickly. And that was so different than doing that with wood, because if you used wood to do this, it would break after maybe 100, maybe less printings, and you would have to get something new, and you couldn't have it that small. So using metal to do this, setting it up like as a typeface, and then creating whole shops that just did this, was a revolution in the way people spread knowledge and information, because it could happen so much faster and so much cheaper. And you could use these letters forever, because each individual letter has its own little thing. Sometimes short words like of or the had their own, because it's easier that way to just have of or the, but still, individual letters. It was a big deal. So let's take a look at the spread of printing, because I think this gives you a good idea of also where Protestant ideas were spreading and how literacy was changing in Europe. So this really great animated map, and I know you guys are keen on those, so here. Okay. So let's look at the spread of printing first, and we can see it over time. Here's it in 1500. We're just looking at 50 years, which is crazy. So I'm going to take it all the way back to 1450, right? Nowhere. I'm going to animate it. So watch the timeline bar up here, and watch as things appear. This is France, Spain. Let's take a map version. Here you go. Here's France, Spain, Germany, Italy, Poland, United Kingdom, which is England during this time period. And Germany wasn't a single country, just to be clear. Italy was not a single country. These countries did not exist. But it'll give you a good sense of where stuff was. So here's it animating. It's going a little slowly for my taste. Come on. There you go. I'll just do it myself. Come on. Slowly, slowly spreading. Oh, look at it. Spreading in Germany. Now you see some in Italy. And now you see all through Germany. This is a huge time period between 1470 and 1475, because printing presses go from, in 5 years, just a couple in the major cities like Netherlands, in Amsterdam, in Cologne, in Frankfurt, in Zurich, and in Rome. And then all of a sudden you have it everywhere, especially northern Italy. Look at that, like over in Spain. You get some all up through this northern part of Germany. And then it just starts to fill in the gaps there. But what's crazy that I'll show you in a second, see, it's just sort of like filling in all of Europe by the time you get to 1500. So it becomes, the word is ubiquitous, as in it's everywhere. But here, let me put where the printing was and see what's really cool. You could click into these cities. Oh, that's so cool. Okay. But you can also see where the trade routes were. Let me come back to 470. Maybe a little before that. So in 465, you can see they're spreading along trading routes because this idea of printing is spreading in areas where you have access to trade so you can trade books. So through here, though, you can see that northern Italy is, of course, the Renaissance that was happening was kind of a big deal. But everywhere else, it's along these trade routes. And it continues to spread along those trade routes, and then it starts to get outside of them. And that's when that's impressive, when you're off the beaten trail and you're like just a printing press in the middle of nowhere. So you also have paper mills, places where they were making paper. You have fairs, as in where they were selling the books. And you can see that those line up pretty well with the major population centers like Paris, like northern Italy, like Rome, like along the northern coast here. These were fairs for selling books and in England. And you can also see where the major universities were. Let me take the fairs off. And these universities were the ones making use of a lot of these books. Anyway, I think that's really cool. You get to watch it spread over time. Let's head back. So, printing spreads throughout Europe. It becomes ubiquitous, as in it's everywhere. And that helps spread some of these ideas, like secularism, which is the loss of religious influence and or religious belief at a societal level, as in the whole society is changing from being totally religiously focused to less religiously focused. Sometimes that means going non-religious entirely, but a lot of times it just means not having religion in every single part of your life and every single part of public life, things you do in society. And this growth in secularism was caused by humanism, like we studied in the Renaissance, these religious wars, which certainly put a bad name on religion for a while, religious division, which helped convince people that there's more ways to look at it than one, and that maybe religion isn't the best thing to have running your society if there's lots of different views on it, but eh. And economics, where the church was opposed to certain ways of doing business, and those ways of doing business were very successful. Individualism was on the rise, which is the growing importance of individuals as opposed to mediating structures such as family, clan, village, and church. So it's more important who you are as an individual and what you do as an individual than what family you belong to, what clan, what village, what church, and what you do as part of those groups. That was brand new. Not brand new, I shouldn't say that, but like the growth of it was staggering and huge during this time period. And economics, those economic structures we talked about in the Renaissance, the secularism led to individualism because you're not totally focused on the church. And also literature from the time period, which picked up on those other themes and those other pushes in the culture, built it out into its own set of ideas. And so you can see down here, these are myths of modern individualism, stories of modern individualism, like Dr. Faust, Don Quixote, Don Juan, Robinson Crusoe, these stories that were focused on the individual, the success of the individual, and your identity as an individual, which is new. Finally, let's talk religious tolerance. And that's the belief that religious diversity is an asset, it's valuable, and not a danger. This was on the rise during this time period because of those religious wars, which made it seem like, oh yeah, this religious intolerance thing, leads to some pretty horrible stuff. Also, secularism, which is that moving away from religion being at the core of everything you do, which leads you to believe like, oh wait, actually, I could live in the same society with people who believe things that I don't, because we don't use religion to solve all the things that we need to solve. Oh. And then also, because there were successful examples of religious tolerance taking place throughout Europe. And sometimes you just need successful examples to prove that it's possible to have a society that isn't just one religion. And it's not like all of a sudden religion becomes great and all of Europe is like, yes, I'll accept you for who you are and exactly as you are and don't change. Because as you see on this bumper sticker, you've got Islam, you've got a sort of general peace symbol, you've got Judaism. You've got paganism, you've got Taoism, and you've also got Christianity, but the one that definitely wasn't accepted and won't be accepted for many, many years that's on this bumper sticker is the issue of gay rights, which is only now in the United States becoming something that we've achieved a true sense of tolerance and acceptance for. But it comes in many ways. We use the same language to talk about that was coming up in this time period to talk about religious tolerance. So you can see the thread there. As a result of this story, the United States society, for example, has strong forms of these values. We'll look at this in just a second on the next page. But you can see those values coming up through this time period, and we trace some of our identity as Americans back to these sets of values, individualism, secularism, and tolerance. science did pretty well as a result of actually having the space to, you know, try stuff that isn't just religious. And the internet is a good example of a revolution in information that gives you a sense of how life-changing it is for the people in the time period to have this printing press. So we see information revolutions as an extension of what happened with the printing press, a fundamental extension of it. So you have the beginning, the first time writing happens, that's a big deal. The printing press is the next big deal, and then the internet. Writing, printing press, internet. Let's take a look at these values things. This is America's 10 core values, according to this one guy. Let me go back a slide. Wayne Baker. Respect for others, acceptance and appreciation, of people of different racial, ethnic, and religious groups. That's a big deal. Self-reliance and individualism, reliance on oneself, independence, emphasis on individual strengths and accomplishments, individual achievement, status, and success. This equal opportunity idea, which maybe comes from the Lutheran view. But then also, you have all of these values really coming from those same sets of these Western European sets of values, which then got spread all over the world because the Europeans kind of conquered everything, which is where we're going next.